So, once again, I missed my upload schedule. I was planning on doing one last week, and I missed it. And I also realized that there was a lot of people asking me to create another one of these Dark Times videos, kind of going more in-depth into what is currently in Dark Times for the submod's release, which is actually very, very soon. So I just decided to kind of kill two birds with one stone and just get the video out. Kind of just get this over with. So without further ado with this intro, let's just get right into it. Dark Times is an AOTR submod that adds a lot of units into the game that we personally would like to have seen go into the game. And a lot of it revolves around a lot of different themes, all the way from like Clone Wars remnants to CIS remnants to indigenous groups to sometimes even just random units that we thought would be really interesting to add to the game. And adds various new units to the game, heroes, missions, planets, etc. Even changes like minor designs like textures to ships, backgrounds like you can see here, unit compositions and just etc. Just things like that. And adds various new units and different compositions and textures and stuff to all of those different factions. Although it does change some stuff with like the overall galactic maps and minor details and the minor factions as well. Mostly the CSA for the minor factions right now, but we probably will be adding a lot more stuff for the Hutts in the future. Anyway, without further ado, let's get into the game and let's start out as Rebels. So while this is loading, I'd actually like to mention right now that there are a bunch of things that have been added, like new starting units to the Galactic Campaign. There are actually three new planets, Shilly, Lothal, and Bracca, that have been added, and they all have their own unique space maps and ground maps, so that's really cool. And with all the capital ships and stuff, there are various different types of fighters that have been added to the game, such as ARC-170s and V-Wings that have been added to the Venators. Those were already in the game, but they were just kind of added to the Venators, as well as other things like I think it was the NTB or MBT, something like that. And some, like, Mandalorian fighters that you could get. And also, just real quick, yeah, I did make a little bit of a custom cutscene for the beginning of AOTR. Let's just watch this real quick. Before we actually start, I actually want to show off the new planets that have been added to space real quick. The new planets have been added, and yes, by the way, these all have planets on the maps, or planets on the map. They all have different space maps, different ground maps. I'm not sure if they're in the minor campaigns, but they are definitely in the major campaign. The first one is Bracca, and Bracca, I believe, is first shown off in canon in the Jedi Fallen Order game, as Imperial or GAR Scrapyard, where all the Clone Wars technology and CIS technology is all being transported to be salvaged for valuable resources that might be put into maybe make more modern technology. And it really made sense for this to go into sort of a Clone Wars-ish themed game, because you can actually build, as the Empire, you can actually build these reclaimed GAR shipyards on these planets, and it allows you to actually build things like, I'm not the Venator for the Empire, they can't build those, but things like the Legacy, which I'll show you later in the Empire segment. Anyway, for the next planet, there's actually Lothal, and this is another one of those weird planets in lore, because this is actually kind of revolving around the Spectres, which I will also be showing off later off in this video, but the Spectres are basically the people from Star Wars Rebels, and they originate from Lothal. That's the main planet that they are on throughout the entire, well, not the entire series, but for most of it. And it's kind of a weird lore standpoint, because in the Rebels, this planet was basically liberated by the time the Empire was actually legitimately facing off against the Rebels and the Death Star was blown up. But in this, because of its location, it was made into a key planet. Because now, since it's right in lore, it's actually right next to Mon Cala, so now it's actually been turned into a fortress world. And it's kind of signifying that the Rebels have been fighting here for a while, and it's made the Empire want to hold on to this planet. And now it's a very, very strategic planet, simply because it's right next to Mon Cala. So now it's had some interesting campaign things as well, because if you want to get Akbar now, you actually have to take Lothal. And as well as that, it's now a strategic holding point for both the Empire and the Rebels, because Well, now you can't just amass all your forces from Mon Cala over to Renvar. Now you have to worry about getting backdoored by an Imperial, a very fortified Imperial planet. Plus, something a little bit extra. We actually added another hyperlane to get to Mon Cala from Honiger down here. Or Honger, however you pronounce that. But it actually connects to Kessel. And before, Honger was really just a sort of planet that was just off in the middle of nowhere. Didn't really do much for the rebels. And if you captured it for the Empire, it gave you a little bit of stuff, but not really much. Now it's a very strategic holding point, because if the Empire manages to catch it, they gathered their forces at Kessel in the mine. It poses even more of a threat for Mon Cala. If Mon Cala keeps this, then it prevents that from happening. So yeah, this area is very strategic all of a sudden. And finally, we have Shilly. Shilly is less of an important planet in lore, but it's added a little bit more importance into the gameplay. Shilly is actually the home planet of the Tortuga species, which have been, cynical to say, enslaved throughout the Star Wars universe, or Star Wars timeline. And because of that, we've made them under the control of the Black Sun. But it is a very key planet for the Rebels once you take it, because it actually gives them a special hero. Okay, so that was all the planets. Let's actually get onto the actual space things now. And for starters, I wanted to mention that, yes, this is sort of a Clone Wars mod, but it's not all just Clone Wars. There's a lot of stuff that goes into this mod, such as new buildings that we have created, and not new buildings, new units in the game, new heroes, new planets like you saw, new design, and etc., etc. It does have a large Clone Wars aspect to it, but it's been balanced, so it's not just a weird, cheesy Clone Wars mod. It actually puts a lot of effort into making the Dark Time submod what it is. Anyway, let's get on to the Clone Wars stuff already. Right off the bat, you're probably going to notice I already have this built here. These are GAR shipyards. These are what allow you to build the Republic warships that have been reclaimed by the Empire's or by the Empire or the Rebellion. The Empire is actually able to build this on both Raka and Quat, and with that, they're able to build the Legacy, which is actually a lesser-known Star Destroyer that was used in the Clone Wars times. Along with that, the Rebels using the GAR shipyards are now actually able to build the Venator Star Destroyer, which I'm sure you all know what it is by now. And you probably know by now pretty much every faction except for the Hapes actually have this. So something cool that the submodders are working on, though I'm not sure if they have it working yet. All the Venators for each faction are going to be a little bit different. So the Venators with the Rebellion are going to have those Sphat cannons. And then I believe like the Black Sun Venator is going to get like nukes or something. I don't know. It's just etc. etc. It's a really cool variation. And then, like I said before, the Legacy is also here, and this is a little, I believe this is a little bit more powerful of a Venator, but it's a lot more expensive, and you can build less of them, I think. I don't think its description has been updated yet. I'm sure that'll be fixed. And then you have the Valiant. I believe you'll probably remember that from the last, some odd video that I made, and I believe it's supposed to be here, and it's not for some reason. I'm not sure why that is. Maybe I have to have, like, a capital shipyard. But no, I'm not able to build it here, so maybe it's just a weird bug that's going on right now. It's kind of the same with the Acclimator, but I'll just talk about that later. Anyway, let's continue with the Arquintance. And the Arquintance has been kind of primarily Imperial ship, and it's been an Imperial ship in lore, so it was kind of a debated thing, but it does originate from the Clone Wars, so we decided to give it to the Rebels. And it, like, I don't know if I could say this enough, I'm probably gonna forget it, that I said it now and say it multiple times in the future. The Clone Wars ships are and units on the ground are gonna be heavily limited. It's not gonna be like you could just build unlimited Clone Wars. You're never gonna want to build anything else because they're super overpowered. They're usually not as good as some of the other units you can get. They're usually like good starter units, and sometimes can be used well in special situations, but they're not like all god ships that you can just use and like just be super overpowered with. They are balanced pretty well. Anyway, yeah, it's the Arquintance. It's pretty similar to the one that the Empire has. Next off, we actually have the CR-70, and this is actually the kind of like the CR-90 Corellian Corvette, except it's a different model, an older model that showed up a lot in the Clone Wars. And again, this is going to be limited to the amount of things you can build, but I like to compare it, like, it's a little bit worse of a CR-90, but it's supposed to be a little bit cheaper, I think. I'm not sure why it's not. That's probably going to be fixed. And then you're also going to notice that we actually have the Spearintech class Corvette, or the Spearna, I can never pronounce that right. It's a Hammerhead Corvette. The hammerheads are probably, I have a good feeling they're going to get added to AOTR at some point in the far future, probably not anytime soon, but the hammerhead corvette is kind of a, it's a very old ship. They definitely weren't as prevalent as like the Clone Wars technology during the Galactic Civil War, but there were definitely some of them around, kind of signified by them showing up in Star Wars Rebels. But yeah, their main power or their main feature is the fact that they have kind of the hammerhead shape in the front and all their guns in the front and et cetera, et cetera. And then there's also the Acclimator. You probably know what the Acclimator is. It's that big, it's kind of like the in-between Arquintons and Venator, that sort of one that's meant to be a ground transport but was turned into more of a fighter transport. And yeah, it's basically a carrier in this. And all the rest of the ships, I actually think I can show over here at Mon Cala. So for the next two ships, the first ship is actually something that this is not confirmed at all. Don't quote me on this, but I have a good feeling it might end up getting added to the original game just because it's such a ship that was actually in original Empire at War and still like is in a lot of other mods. So I wouldn't be surprised. It's the assault. It's actually the Alliance Assault Frigate Mark II. If you don't know, you could actually build this ship called the Dreadnought in here, and you could actually upgrade that to either the Alliance Light Frigate, or, like, can I do that here, actually? I know I can do that at one of these planets, but you can upgrade to be, like, the Alliance Assault Frigate or the Alliance Light Frigate, which is this or another one. And in this, you can actually now upgrade from the Alliance Assault Frigate to the Alliance Assault Frigate Mark II, or you can just build it separately for some reason. I think that's going to be updated. That might just be because it's just to make it a little bit easier. So yeah, it does require Global Tech 3 simply because it's such an advanced ship, so it's usually easier just to upgrade from Alliance Mark II to Mark III. But yeah, it's basically just a better version of the Alliance Assault Frigate, where it has, I think, better shields, better forward-facing firepower, a little bit better speed, I'm not sure about that. And then moving on to the Pelta. The Pelta is less of a repair ship, like it's shown off in multiple other mods, but now it's turned into more of just a regular frigate. And it's meant to be used as more of a support ship, sort of like the Nebulon B, where it kind of just supports your ships and deals with enemy frigates and such. And moving on from that, we actually have two of the bigger ships, one of which is something that will most likely never get added to AOTR, and one of which is actually probably going to be in the next AOTR update. The two ships are the Lucre Hulk Prime and the MC-75. Let's start with the MC-75. It's actually a Mon Calamari ship that has been only recently showed up in Rogue One and in Squadrons, and it's not quite as powerful as Squadrons shows it off to be. It can't 1v1 a Star Destroyer, but it's definitely still a powerful ship. I would say about the same power, or maybe a little bit more than the MC-80 Justice. Where it's what you would think a Mon Calamari ship to be. Kind of just a mixed sort of thing with a lot of shields and a little bit less firepower than you would normally want, but it could definitely still get the job done. And then the next ship is Lucre Hulk Prime. This is actually a ship that shows up a lot more in Legends. I don't believe it shows up in canon, and it does eventually get destroyed by the second Death Star, so possible campaign things in the future, I don't know. But yeah, this is a Lucre Hulk. It's meant to be in Legends, a fighter training facility. It never really was used that often in battle scenarios unless it was really needed. And it's a Lucre Hulk, so it deploys a ton of fighters. So yeah, this is basically just a giant carrier. It can tank a lot of stuff, and it does have a fire repair ability, but you don't want to set it in all-out zone against like a bunch of Star Destroyers, because its fires could do a lot, but it can only take so much. And finally, there is one more ship that I am missing, and I'd like to mention right now that a lot of these ships, you can get them from this. This is probably like one of the main resources of getting them, but it's limited for the amount of ships that you can get from here. The cool thing that you can actually do in this is now you can actually get these ships from missions. So like say you get a riot mission, or like you have to take over a planet, and once you do, you'll actually get one of these ships. And one ship that you can't actually build, you can only get them from missions, kind of like getting Venators for the, or like kind of getting Venators in regular AOTR, is actually the Thantra. It's sort of a version of the Hammerhead Corvette, a little bit bigger and a lot more powerful. I'd probably compare it to maybe what the Dreadnought is, and it kind of has the same aspect of the Sphyrinta, the ship that we have back here, where it's basically has a lot of forward-facing firepower and sideways-facing firepower.
So, on to the Rebel ground units and heroes. So,
First of all, I would like to mention that most of the units actually... Real quick, I would like to do this. There we go. Just turn off the music there. I would like to mention real quick that a good majority of the ground units that we've added for the Rebels are actually Clone Wars era units, and they are, like I've said multiple times already, pretty lore-based, where they're mostly like salvage from shipyards, but more like abandoned factories on grounds and stuff, or traded for other ships, and they have pretty limited amounts, but they are definitely more prevalent as like the main ground units of the Rebellion. Well, I shouldn't say main ground units of the Rebellion. The main ground units for the Rebellion that we have given them. Anyway, I've stopped talking, just get on with it already. So the first two tanks that I could show off here are actually built by the Light Factory, and they are the AT-RT Company and the AT-AP. The AT-RTs are kind of like, well, I don't know what else to say besides, like comparison, besides they are very AT-RT-y. There's something like this in the Empire that you can get, like these little, they're kind of like tiny versions of the AT-RT that don't expose the pilot, and they're just kind of, you get them in large groups. They're sort of like that, where they're more meant to be supporting the infantry, scouting out farther ahead of the infantry and coming back, actually surviving, unlike most of the scouts in this game. And yeah, they're mainly anti-infantry, help out with maybe minor tanks and just supporting the infantry. The other tank is the AT-AP, which I'm sure you have all run into multiple times facing off against the Hutts and the CSA. And these things are massive artillery pieces, and they are annoying. But, well, they're annoying to fight, but they're pretty fun to use. And yeah, they're basically artillery pieces that can only fire forward, so you gotta position them carefully, and if you're attacking them, you gotta go around them. Okay, so the next two tanks, or I should just say next one tank and one air unit that can be built, are the TX-130T and the Low Altitude Assault Transport, or the LAAT. Let's start with the TX-130T. The TX-130T in the Clone Wars was mainly used as kind of like an in-between tank, in between like the light things like the AT-RT and the AT-TE, where it was meant to kind of take out both infantry and larger vehicles. It definitely punches above its like size because of that of those two big turrets that it has in the front, but it's definitely a lot more vulnerable than you'd think. It's a pretty average tank, I would definitely say. And then you have the LAAT, which also comes in with a side thing. Like, over here, you know how you can build the CODIS militia with militia soldiers and the militia commando platoons. You can now also build the MAAT gunship, which is basically, I like to just say it's the LAAT, except upgraded in terms of firepower, health, maybe carrying capacity. I'm not sure that one. But anyway, the LAAT is... You've probably seen it multiple times already. It was the main transport used by the clones during the Clone Wars, and many of them were used by the Rebels as transports. That was kind of simulated by dropping infantry down using LAATs in the game, but they were never actually used in the battlefield as actual units, besides maybe shooting things from the drop point. So now you can actually buy these LAATs and use them. So they're kind of like, not the U-Wing, I really do wish the U-Wing could carry troops, but unfortunately it can't right now, since it's more of a actual, like an air unit, like the Z-95, you can't exactly land those, but with the LAAT, you can actually do that now, where you can pick up troops, you can bring them somewhere else, you can drop them off. They basically do the same thing as those big Rebel transports, the same one that this General Riken person gets, except I would basically just say they're a lot better at it. So yeah, like I said before, you can get the MAAT as well. That's basically like an upgrade LAAT. As well as that, the CODIS militia have also been upgraded a little bit, so they have different loadouts, different guns and stuff, but I won't go too far into that. So yeah, the last two things that you can build are the ATTEs, which are basically like the big tanks of the GAR. There's nothing else really to say. They are the big tanks of the GAR. They were mainly used against larger vehicles and weren't super good at anti-infantry. They did have those frontal cannons that could do some anti-infantry work, but not a ton. And yeah, they had that giant cannon on the front that did a ton of damage. So yeah, expect when you're fighting against those or using those, they're going to be very good against enemy tanks. But the other thing is actually something that you need to get on Ilum. So unfortunately, I can't show it off right now, since I'd actually need to like gather up pretty much all of my forces and then just make a massive push over here. Plus, I'd actually need to get the New Republic so I can get the thing. But on Ilum, you're actually able to build, you were previously able to build Jedi on Ilum. They were kind of mediocre units, but what the Submod has done is they've actually given the Jedi new abilities and made them all, like, individual units. So now they all have their own designs and textures, and now they all actually have their own abilities, their own stats, like attack and defense stats, and et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah, now Jedi are actually a lot more worth actually building. Okay, so for heroes that the Rebellion gets, they actually get quite a few, and they're quite scattered around the entire map, surprisingly. So, for starters, let's start off with the, I don't think this was the first hero, but it's probably the one that's probably been heard of the most. It's the Morningstar class Venator, controlled by Aurelia. And this is basically a Venator class Star Destroyer that's been refitted with, like, a specialized SVAT cannon that's meant not really to destroy, target one specific part of the ship and do a lot of damage there. It's supposed to do a decent amount of damage to a large area, and it's kind of like a shrapnel bomb in my opinion. It's more like shredding the surrounding areas. So it's not doing a ton of damage, but it's definitely doing enough so that they know it's there. Plus, it tears through fighters pretty well. So it's definitely a ship that you both want to use in battle, but also protect, because it is still a Venator class Star Destroyer. It has basically the same loadout in terms of defense, or not defense, I should say health, as a normal Venator does. So you don't want this thing to get focused down, or it's gonna get destroyed pretty fast. As well as that, Aurelia themselves actually goes down onto the ground, and apparently the lore behind Aurelia is that they are actually kind of a rogue sort of Jedi, and what they do is they actually go down to the ground, and on the ground they wield a double-blade lightsaber. They get two squads of defense infantry, and the special thing about them is that they actually get an ARC 170 on the ground, which is kind of... In my opinion, I don't like the fact that that big hulking thing can do ground strafes, like, with the mechanics that AOTR has, but at the same time, it's a ground ARC 170. I mean, it's been done before. I just don't like that mechanic in Star Wars lore. But yeah, it's definitely a cool ship. I'd say the ground ARC 170, since it is a special ship, it's kind of like the X-Wing, where it has a slower turning rate, slower accelerating rate, but it could fire a lot more than the other ships. And I believe it has a lot more health than most ships, but since it's slower, it's much bigger of a target, so it kind of balances the ship out. As well as that, there is another hero that I can't currently show off, because, again, it's super far away from where I can actually reach it. It's actually on the planet of Shilly, and what the hero is actually a hero called Laddie. Well, for one, they come in a Venator, so a lot like the other one, and yeah, Venators seem to be a common theme for these two heroes, but for two, they actually get something that's a little bit of a unique mechanic. It has been done before with different heroes, I believe, well, maybe only one hero, that's for the Black Sun, but what they do is they actually bring in a fleet. So, let's just use Garmbel Iblis as an example. In space, when you drop him, he comes out with his one dreadnought, and then two dreadnoughts come out beside him. So you basically get through two free dreadnoughts that, even though if you lose them, you'll get them back if you, say, like, retreat Iblis himself and then go back into the battle later on. So, yeah, it's sort of like that mechanic, where the Venator will hyperspace in, and then a fleet of GAR ships, including Acclimators, those Arquintances, the CR-70s, and I believe a Dreadnought, and, like, they all have their own fighters as well, most of them anyways, but yeah, it's basically what we like to call a pocket fleet, and this fleet is pretty expensive in terms of pop cap as well, because, well, it's a whole fleet. You can't just make it like a normal hero where it takes up, like, at most 10. With this one hero, it actually takes up 30 to bring them into the battle, but at the same time, you get all those free ships. So, yeah, it's kind of like you can bring them in if you want to, but when you lose all those ships, you basically have, like, unless Laddie dies themselves, then you basically have 30 taken up pop cap that you can't use later on. The next hero is actually built on the Intelligence Center, just like the Morningstar is. The next hero is actually Faye, which is actually a hero based off of a developer for Awakening the Rebellion. This hero is basically another one of those pocket fleets where they bring in, they are in a Marauder cruiser, and they bring in two Marauder cruisers that are slightly more weaker than they are around them. So, yeah, it's basically a Marauder cruiser pocket fleet. And then there are a few more heroes like Winkler and... Clorinda or something like that, which are both heroes in the Legacy class Star Destroyer, which I've shown off earlier, and the Valiant class Star Destroyer, which you've probably seen in a previous video. It's a lot like the Legacy, I believe. It's a little bit more towards the weapon side instead of being more towards the armored side. And I believe there's actually two other heroes that I currently can't show off. One, I believe, is built on Bakura, and one is built on Corellia. These are both also... this one is a pocket fleet where the hero is actually called the Wolf Pack, and it's not actually the Wolf Pack, it's just more kind of themed based off of that. It's actually a fleet of those Corellian ships, so again, it brings in a lot of Corellian ships, but at the same time, it takes up a lot of pop cap. And then the other hero is over here is actually Sly, which is, again, another AOTR dev built on Bakura, and they actually get a Backring Destroyer. And then finally, there is one, or technically two heroes that spawn... over on Concord Dawn and on Lothal. These two heroes are kind of interesting because many, many people have wanted them to be part of AOTR, but since they kind of have shaky lore in both Rebels and just regular TV shows, since their lore is still constantly being written out for them in this time period specifically, they haven't been added yet. But so the two heroes are actually the Spectres and one of the Spectres members who comes separately, Sabine Wren. Now, these two heroes, like, again, they're kind of shaky lore, but they don't include everybody. Like, they don't include Kanan or Ezra because, well, in this point, Kanan is dead and Ezra is off in the unknown regions. Sorry, I probably should have put a spoiler alert in front of that. But the other heroes are definitely here. So, the Spectres actually come with Lothal. You've probably already seen this. Lothal is the new planet that was added to the game, but is one of the new planets that was added to the game, I should say. And once you capture it, you can actually build the Spectres, which come with, I believe it's Hera, Chopper, Rex, and I actually think that's it. It's just Hera, Chopper, and Rex. Well, it's not just Hera, Chopper, and Rex. Sabine also spawns in, Sabine is also one of the Spectres, but Sabine is actually built separately, and she actually comes with her own Mandalorian group. And at this point in time, it's not Zabrak species, it's something else, but he was, like, separated from the Spectres, so it's only the Spectres that were confirmed to be working, sort of working with the Rebels. Like, the Spectres were confirmed to be working with the Rebels, so that's why they're putting their own group. Sabine, I'm not sure if she was confirmed to be working with the Rebels, so that's kind of why she got separated, and has her own Mandalorian group, and etc., etc. Okay, so the next one I want to do is actually the space units for the Empire, and one of the major things I'd like to mention, this isn't actually related to the Empire, this is related to the game. You're probably going to run into a few bugs. This is a very early game, as this video is coming out, we're probably going to be very soon to launching, or maybe if you're in the future and the game is already launched, you're going to probably find a lot of bugs, not similar to how AOTR is. AOTR is pretty bug-free so far, but yeah, you're probably going to find a lot of bugs. The major bug that you're probably going to run into is the fact that when you exit the game, like... Oh, actually, I want to show you this real quick. Okay, so sorry for not cutting myself off there. That was actually the intro to the new campaign for the Empire. And yeah, I have one of those intros for the Rebels, as I probably already showed you. And yeah, that was the Imperial one. But anyway, like I was saying, there's a major bug in this game where if you actually quit out of the game, if you press quads and quit the game. It won't actually quit you to the menu. It'll actually quit you entirely out of the game, so you have to restart it. That's currently a bug we're dealing with, and we don't know if we're going to have it fixed by 1.0, but it's going to be something that you might just have to deal with. It shouldn't affect saves. You could still save your game perfectly fine and load saves just fine. It's only when you quit the game that it when it shuts down. So it's going to be a minor inconvenience, but it's still definitely something that you'll have to watch out for. Okay, and on to the space units. Most of them are going to be found on Kuat and Corellia, mainly just because those are the two main shipyards that they start out with. And we're going to start with the Vigil Corvette. The Vigil Corvette is what I like to think of as kind of the Empire's version of in between the Arquintans and the Acclimator, where it's sort of supposed to be a support ship for the bigger ships, but it's more meant for taking out enemy minor ships, not like the the Arquintans. The Arquintans seems to be like a major support ship. It helps out with taking out capital ships that the ISDs are currently taking out. And it can sort of attack enemy frigates and corvettes and do good at that, but not as well as the Vigil does, at least in my testing. And then we move on to the Predator-class Star Destroyer and the Victory Mark II frigate. The Victory Mark II frigate is actually something that doesn't show up in canon. This is actually something from the Starkiller series, I believe. And yeah, I believe it's actually more of a Nebulon 2-esque sort of ship, where it's, again, one of those support ships meant for taking out enemy frigates and enemy starfighters. The Predator-class Star Destroyer is a bit like the in-between the Venator and the Victory, where it has a lot of forward-facing firepower, and it's relatively weak, but it also has the ability to actually you see these little side panels here, it's actually able to fold those back and release a volley of missiles at the enemy, although it can't move while it's doing that. And those missiles are a lot more powerful than the ones that the Victory launches. So, yeah, it's definitely a valuable ship, but it's a lot more rare in the Star Wars universe, so I'm guessing it's probably going to get a little bit of a, not a little bit, it's probably going to get a build limit in the future. And then we move on to the one ship that we all probably know by now. It's shown up everywhere. The Raider-class Corvette is an anti-starfighter sort of Corvette that's supposed to kind of rival the CR-90 in a way. And this is going to be in the AOTR's next update, but that update's not going to be coming out for a while. So I guess if you want an early look at it, you sort of can come to here. But I don't know if this is going to be anything like the one that the AOTR people are cooking up. It's not even doesn't even have the same model or texture. I think it's going to be completely different. So you'll have to keep your eye out on what the AOTR devs are saying. Now just base it off the one that we have. Anyway, yeah, it is basically an anti-starfighter sort of thing, and it's purely anti-starfighter. It's not really much in the way of anti-frigate or corvette. Okay, moving on to the capital ships, we have the Snub-Nosed Star Destroyer, or the Procusator-class Star Destroyer. This is a ship that's very similar to the ISD. It's a little bit shorter and stubbier, but it's got a little bit of a different loadout. I believe it has a little bit less hull. I cannot be sure on that for my testing. It seems to survive a little bit, it seems to die a little bit quicker than the ISD, but in return, it has a little bit different loadout. It has a lot of guns on it, like the ISD, but its main feature is down the middle of it. It actually has three main turrets instead of having turrets on the side. And those three main turrets, I believe, are super powerful, so whatever they hit, this is going to take a lot of damage. Also, you could probably tell, but right here, you could actually see the reclaimed GAR shipyard. And once you build that, you're actually able to build the Legacy, which I showed you before, that Star Destroyer, but in even more limited number than the Rebels were able to build because ISD's galore. And the next ship is probably the one that your eyes instantly went to as you saw this. It's the Crimson Command Victory Star Destroyer 2. These are sort of late game things, and you get a very limited amount of them, but what these are basically a line of Victory Star Destroyers that were built with a different material just because that's what they had on hand. I'm not a super big fan of the design of these things, but I do know that the lore is very cool, and the fact that these things are a little bit more expensive simply because these things almost can match an ISD with their firepower and hull strength. So yeah, they're a little bit more valuable than a normal Victory Star Destroyer, but they're a little bit more expensive as well. They also look, they're red. They are very red. And the last ship that I need to show off for the Empire is actually the Secure-class Star Destroyer. This is a GAR super ship, and these things were, I'm just going to say, you're probably going to see these in other mods shown off a lot bigger because they're compared to the Venators, but these things are basically like an early ISD because they're about the maybe the same, a little bit more have the same firepower and strength as maybe an ISD or a Tector, but in terms of like maybe like the ISD 2, it's not quite as powerful as that. But anyway, yeah, these are basically like a reclaimed GAR ship, and they're built similar to like the Luger Hulk and the Executor, where you build it and it takes a really long time to build, but once you do build it, it's a pretty valuable ship. It's not as valuable as you might think, but it's still a pretty good ship to have, especially early on. And I would like to mention that it is a GAR ship, so you're probably going to get a very limited amount of these. Also, I would like to mention real quick that these ships do, like, once again, they do pure missions, but they also do get new starting positions, like, no, not over here, maybe at the Maw, no, not at the Maw. Well, we do have some on Braca. These units will be actually showing up in various different places, kind of like Canon does it, where they'll actually be showing off at starting units, like you'll get a Victory Mark II frigate at Deveron, and I believe somewhere up here, like at Fresha, you'll get a Raider Corvette defending Fresha, and etc, etc. It's kind of cool. Okay, so for the Imperial ground units, they don't have nearly as many as the Rebels were given. The Black Sun have a little bit more as well, but it's still the units that have been added are still pretty cool and pretty unique, so let's talk about them real quick. The first one that you're going to notice all over the place is actually the ATTE. These are actually those ATTEs from the Clone Wars, and I've already probably shown them off with the Rebels, but these things are a little bit more different from what the Rebels have. I believe they're the same in terms of how they act on the ground and in space as transports and stuff, but on the galactic level, you cannot actually buy these. You can only get them from missions or, I believe missions and starting units. That's the only way you can get these, kind of symbolizing that they don't build ATTEs anymore. They build AT-ATs because those are far better. But anyway, yeah, this is the ATT. It works a lot like an ATT. It's a pretty big battle tank that has medium to heavy armor, so it's pretty powerful. It has the giant turret in the front and multiple turrets on its bottom, the midsection. And yeah, it's a big walker that operates like a tank. Like a tank should in Star Wars. And then we move on to the ATMP. This is a lot like the ATRT in a way where it's sort of like a mix between that and the ATSD. It has a lot of anti-infantry capabilities with its missile launchers / grenade launchers, things on the sides. No, it's definitely missile launchers. And it actually has a rotary chain gun in the middle. So yeah, it definitely acts as a very good anti-infantry and anti-light tank vehicle, but it's definitely a lot more rare. You don't see these all that often, and they are definitely very, very easy to kill if you're not paying attention, because these things are like ATRTs. These things can get like pop-shotted by missiles if you're not careful. I don't know if it's going to be one missile, but a few could definitely take this thing out if you're not careful with it. And you only get three of them, so yeah, they're powerful, but you got to be careful. Okay, so the next three heroes are... next three units are actually built in places that I actually will have to build real quick. Give me a second. Okay, and for the next units we have are actually built on the prison... Like I said before, the prisons and level 3 barracks. We have the Evo Troopers and the Navy Commandos. Let's start with the Navy Commandos. These troopers were more like specialized units, where they were, I would say they're a little bit better than normal stormtroopers would be, and they're more meant for like defending key areas that are very important to the Empire, such as prisons and such things like that. Yeah, they're basically like the guards. I like just to call them the guards, mainly just because they're kind of like... They're sort of like a royal guard, but not. They're meant to guard the more important key Imperial places, but they're not too different from the Stormtroopers. They're just a little bit better, I would say. And then finally, for these, for the Empire, we actually have the Evo Trooper and the Shadow Evo Trooper. The Evo Troopers are actually these environmental troopers that are meant for definitely like the specialized things and more... hazardous environmental environments, what am I saying? But they were definitely meant for like going out on other planets, and I believe these units are stealth, even though they don't show up. At least the Shadow Evo Troopers are, but yeah, they're definitely a lot more powerful than the normal infantry, and like specifically selected as troopers who
who hate alien species are willing to go out and destroy them for the Empire to gain more territory and such. And the difference mainly is the Shadow Evil Troopers are definitely a lot better with like I believe they actually have a lot better armor and a lot better weapons as well, but they made, because of that, they were extremely rare, and there's only like three of them. Well, it's not three of them, three squads of them, three teams of eight, and besides that, it's mainly just these troopers. So for heroes, and actually the first one I'd like to mention is actually Captain Tuck, which actually comes in one of those Crimson ISDs that I showed you earlier. This one right here. Or Crimson Victory Star Destroyer, sorry, but he's basically a unit that will actually both have that Crimson Victory Star Destroyer with specialized TIE fighters in space, which is really cool, but also actually have a specialized unit on the ground, which both has one of those special textured TIE interceptors on the ground, which is actually a really special thing, a lot like one of the Rebel heroes, which I'll show you in a second, but also gets his own, gets two of those Navy troopers that come with him, the ones that I showed off over here, and actually comes with himself, his own character model. The character himself acts more like an officer that you would see like coming with TIE fighters, which kind of is fitting because instead of having like a group of TIE fighters, he has the TIE interceptor and a bunch of Navy troopers, so that's kind of cool. And then the final two heroes I would like to show off are actually two heroes that are not currently confirmed to be in the 1.0 release, simply because they're currently having some issues, and we're not sure if we're going to be able to fix them by 1.0. It's issues with like special abilities that they have that actually they are very similar in. I'll explain those to you guys in a second. But the heroes are actually Mara Jade, or not Mara Jade, it is Mara Jade. Where is she? Here she is. Mara Jade and Inferno Squadron. I actually want to bring these two units together just so it'll be easier to explain what they do. So a little bit more context into what these two units do. Inferno Squadron is the campaign squadron for Star Wars Battlefront 2. I believe it's consistent of those Iden Versio and those two other stormtroopers that are more like the special the commando troopers or whatever you want to call them. But basically, they come with the three units on the ground, those three specialized units, and they're able to do basically what you'd expect a specialized stealth unit to do. They're really good on the ground. They can't really fight off an entire army, but in taking out individual units and kind of focusing down maybe even a medium tank or maybe a hero, that's sort of what they're specialized in. And then Mara Jade is a little bit different. Mara Jade is sort of like another one of those Imperial officers on the ground. She has her own like weapons and actually comes with Navy troopers as well. But something special, one of her abilities that is like one of the new abilities to AOTR that's really cool, is that she can actually bring down more troopers with her if she presses an ability. And no, it's not something that she can constantly do. It's not like an overpowered ability. She can only do it once, and then the ability has like a 4-hour cooldown to kind of simulate that you only brought down once. But yeah, say you're in the middle of a battle and you're running out of forces, you can retreat Mara Jade, bring down forces, and then go back into the battle with your replenished reinforcements, or you can even bring them down in battle, though they'll probably just end up getting killed. It's a cool little strategic thing that you can do with the unit. It adds a lot of really cool things to the mod. But a big thing that is actually done with these two heroes that I'm not sure if it's actually in the rest of AOTR along with that ability that Mara Jade has is that if either of these two units die, they actually transition over to their proper faction. So I believe if they both die, they both go over to the Rebellion. They respawn on Mon Cala or something like that. I've not actually tested that with either of them yet. I think I actually might have to do that right now. That might be something fun I should do. Construction complete. Wait, no, because it's... No, never mind. Complete. I'll just explain what happened. So basically, it actually changed the icon of Inferno Squadron to be orange, and then Mara Jade stays the same. But besides that, it basically keeps them mostly the same. Inferno Squadron turns into the good guy Inferno Squadron that works for the New Republican canon, but can also work, I guess, for the Rebels in this. And Mara Jade actually now drops like specialized Rebel infantry instead of the Navy troopers that she used to drop. Okay, moving on to the Black Sun. I am going to be a complete fool with this and not know where everything is, but let's just give it my best try here. So, onto the Black Sun space units. I believe they can all be built on Geonosis, and sorry if I'm kind of stumbling around with the Black Sun. I'm not super familiar with how their mechanics works. Like, what is corruption? How does this work? But anyways, let's just get started with the two units that are actually already present with the Rebels, the CR-70 and the Pelta-class frigate. These do both these are both units that I already showed off in the Rebels previously, but they've both also been given to the Black Sun, seeing that they have also acquired multiple different units that the Rebels, or that the JR used to have. Anyway, before I fumble over my words even more, the CR-90 is... or the CR-70 is what I like to compare to the CR-90, because the Rebels have the CR-90 and the Black Sun also have that CR-90 armored version. So I kind of like to compare it to that, where I believe this CR-90, it both has a different paint job and is a little bit more armored, but the version that the Rebels have is a little faster and has a little bit more firepower. As for the Pelta, I believe the only difference is that, like, this one's just, like, it's a lot similar, where the one that the Rebels have actually has the open back and different texture, so it's a little bit faster, but this one's a little bit more better in the terms of firepower. And then we have two ships here, the Warlord Heavy Cruiser and the Akawaka thing. It's very hard. This is just really weird. I don't know how to pronounce this, but this one is basically a freighter. It's like the IPV for the Empire. It's kind of like supposed to be like an anti-fighter supporting with frigates and corvettes sort of ship. And then the Warlord Heavy Cruiser is supposed to be sort of like the Hammerhead, definitely with the design, but it has a lot of forward firepower and sideways facing firepower, and it's a very long range ship. It has very powerful turrets on the front that are able to do a lot of damage, both from long range and close quarters, along with all the turrets that it has on the side. So facing off against this thing with smaller ships is definitely a challenge. And probably the big ship is that I actually need to show off here is actually the what is it called? The Variegator. The Variegator. I need to memorize that name. The Variegator is actually a ship that I didn't want to show off with the Rebels because it's actually buildable with both the Rebels and the Black Sun if you control Mandalore. With Mandalore, you like if you have the Rebels, you have to have a capital shipyard, or if you have the Black Sun, you have to have this Mandalorian shipyard. But basically, what it is, it's actually the Mandalorian's version of a Star Destroyer that was built sort of during the Old Republic times, and I'm not sure if they built a new one or they have an old one just laying around, but this is basically symbolizing that, like, the Mandalorians that are on this planet are able to build their own ships and side with the factions that they want based off of which faction controls that planet, and whichever faction controls the planet is actually able to build that ship. So the Variegator is a pretty interesting ship to have control of. And I'll show you what it looks like once it actually finishes building this thing. Okay, so here it is. Here is the Variegator. And yeah, it's basically just what it looks like. It looks like a massive ISD sort of retextured and different model.
At your command.
I shouldn't say retextured and different model. This is like an entirely different ship, so of course it has a different texture, different model. It's not just like an ISD copying and pasting over. This is actually its own whole ship. It probably has maybe the same firepower as an ISD-2. Don't quote me on that. I have never fought the two together in my testing. I just know that is a pretty powerful ship. Okay, so on to the Black Sun ground units. They actually have, let's just say, we added quite a few more droid units to their mix. It was kind of going under the understanding of they had these droid factories and they could already produce these three units that you or these four units that you can see at the front. They can produce B-1s, B-2s, the AAT tanks, and the destroyer droid companies. So we thought that there's no like real point why they wouldn't be able to produce more. Plus, it kind of just settles down the whole fact that people are constantly asking for more droid units to be added. So we did it. We gave the Black Sun a little bit more droid units. They can now get dwarf spider droids, the Hailfire droid tank company, the BX Commando droids, and the Crab droids. Each of these are their own units in a certain way. These two are kind of like the infantry supporting tanks, where they're both able to do a lot of damage to infantry and a little bit of damage to light tanks, but anything beyond that is a little bit more challenging for them. The Commando droids are basically an upgraded version of these two, where they are a little bit more limited, but I think they're going to be a little bit more limited in the future, but they're definitely going to be a little bit harder to take down. And so against big groups of infantry, they're not going to do super well, but on their own, I think they're going to do very well. And then you have the Hailfire tank, which is basically the Katusha of the Black Sun. It's just, or the CIS, I should say. It's a giant missile platform that's very delicate and easy to destroy, but can do a ton of damage if you use it. And then finally, the other ground unit that's actually been added is the Flamethrower ATTE, which I can't actually show off right now without building something and taking forever to build. It's an ATTE that has been refit by the Black Sun to have flamethrowers on it. And it kind of sounds ludicrous, but it's actually quite the cool unit. You actually have to use it strategically, where you can't just send it in and expect it to win. Or you can't just use it like as a normal tank, where you keep it in the front. It's a little bit more delicate. It has a giant flamethrower on the front, so you can expect that. But it also does a lot of damage to enemy infantry, and you can't really do all that much damage to enemy tanks. And it sets stuff on fire, so it's kind of a win-win. Now on to the heroes. There are a few heroes I also can't show off simply because I'd have to actually go to the end game in order to show them off. One of the heroes, I'll just start out, is actually Gax Gester, I believe it's pronounced. And it's actually an MC-80 Liberty hero that actually spawns on Mon Cala once you take it over from the Rebels. And like I said, it's an MC-80. It's been refit with some new weapons, I believe, but it's a very difficult hero to get, but it's kind of worth it because he's pretty powerful. The next hero is actually the Fatal Mistake, which actually spawns over here on Ilum. I kind of thought it spawned down here at Ratak, but I guess Ilum is also a good place for it to spawn, especially with the new planets and the fact that's kind of cut off from everything else. But anyway, let's just keep going with this. He's in another one of those Venators, another refit Venator, and it's, let's just say, very powerful Venator. Not too powerful to the point where, like, it's not Morningstar powerful where we're going to have to, like, nerf it based off of community reviews, but it's definitely a powerful Venator you have to watch out for, and again, it's still a Venator. It's powerful in the way of weapons, but with its shields and armor, it is, it's pretty easy to destroy, just like all the other Venators in this game. The next ship is actually, or the next hero, I should say, is actually Koryak. It's another unit that's based off of a AOTR developer. Yeah, we have a lot of those, but hey, we tried to be nice to them about it, and a lot of them wanted it, so might as well. Basically, what this unit is, I'm not super familiar with what he flies. Apparently, he flies a Sabbath-class cruiser, and he's a Black Sun hero, so I'm guessing he's not super, like, he's not super powerful, but he's able to be used if you use him correctly. A lot of micromanaging. Anyway, now that I am in the Black Sun, I actually want to talk about the two things that we have done with the CSA and the Hunts. Currently, those two factions currently don't have all that much to them. They currently have a few unique fighters and capital ships, but not really all that many. So the sub mod has been kind of working on that, so has the AOTR mod. But anyway, the CSA have actually been giving a little bit more unique ships in the way of not really loadouts, but it's been given its own textures. So I believe that's the Victory, the Venator, the Recusant, and the Dreadnought all have their own version, like a CSA version now. So they all look different, a little bit more aligned to what the CSA look like. Plus, like I said before, all the Venators are different. The CSA actually have more of an ion-based Venator now. And along with that, they are actually now able to build a Lucre Hulk, which is kind of like going along the lines that they have a bunch of recovered Clone Wars technology. And their Lucre Hulk is also sort of built, has its own paint job to kind of base them off of the CSA. I can't really show those off because I can't really build anything with the CSA, but yeah, there's nothing else really to say besides that. Also, the Hunts are now actually able to build those two ships that I showed off to you. The Warlord and the Eka Waka thing, the Arb Freighter. The Hunts are now able to build those two ships, so it gives them a little bit more variety. Here, but let's talk about what the CSA have for ground units. They have a lot of similar things to what the Black Sun have now. They're now able to build things like that. They're able to pretty much build all of these units, these three, the B2s, the B1s, the AATs. They're able to build the BX Commando droids. They're actually already able to build the AATs. I'm not sure about that. And now there are actually two. There's actually a couple new units that we added onto them. Now they're able to actually build the SP-9 and MP-2 tanks. And as well as that, they get two sort of specialized units. The Ground Razor Fighter and the Falchion. The Falchion is actually the big tank that you see in the Clone Wars with that big laser on it that takes out that the center to the Lucre Hulks in Episode 2 Attack of the Clones. It's that big tank. And yeah, those tanks are pretty powerful. They aren't able to be built by any of the other factions except for right now because of testing. But yeah, they're pretty powerful tanks that are able to destroy enemy tanks really easily and kind of go through infantry, but not really all that well. And they're pretty well armored, but not to the point where you can just send them in and expect them to get work done all by themselves. And then you have the Ground Razor Fighter. This is basically just, I got it as compared to the C-95. The Razor is something that looks a lot like the T-Wing. It kind of looks like more of a, sort of like a modern jet combined with a T-Wing. And it's given more of like a modern jet sort of look. And these are basically these ground fighters that are able to do basically what the Z-95 on the ground can do. They are very powerful and, well, they're not super powerful, I should say. They are powerful if you know how to use them right. They get shot down pretty easily with AA if you're not being careful with them.
And that's it. That's all the heroes that have been, or all the units that Dark Times has added to AOTR. And yeah, you could probably see there are a lot of them, and we have done our best to balance them out. There's also probably going to be various bugs, glitches that you find in the game, and probably imbalanced units. And there are also just, I don't know what else to say, there's various different things that you can do with the units, different tactics. There's probably some units that I ended up missing, and if there are, I'm sure I'll be scolded by the other developers of Dark Times. But anyway, that was Dark Times for you so far. So yeah, if you do like the submod, once it comes out, it's going to be coming out very soon. Make sure to try and subscribe or just try it out. Tell us if you like it in the comments of Steam, or you can check out our Discord page. I will be leaving a link in the description of this video. But anyways, like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video. Hit the notification bell if you don't want to miss another video. And as always, goodbye.